medical profession. So joining us now is Michelle Roden with Nurses Against Mandatory Vaccines. Thank you for joining us, Michelle.
Thank you for having me. I just wanted to make a correction that I'm not the founder of Nurses Against Mandatory Vaccines. I'm a founding board member, so I'm one of the original members, but Amy Kenyon is actually the founder.
Okay, good. Now, I want to go back and recall for our viewers what you told us on May 1st that you had seen being done with young babies, premature babies who were suffering in the neonatal intensive care, what they were saying about vaccines at the time.
Well, I had mentioned that they go ahead and vaccinate premature infants on time, meaning that once they are 2 months old, they're ready for their two-month vaccines, regardless of the fact that they may still have supposed to have been inside their mother's stomachs and not even born yet. Mm-hmm. And some of the things that we're seeing and are being said are things like a neonatologist calling from the step-down unit down to level three to the more intensive unit saying, hey, I'm going to give these four babies their two-month vaccines this weekend, so I just want to make sure you have four beds ready because we know they're all going to have issues and need increased care.
And that was bombshell information because that violates one of the core ethics of the medical foundation profession that we've always seen, and that is first do no harm. They knew this was going to harm the children, but they were going to go ahead and blindly or follow this schedule.
Absolutely. You know, and I mentioned that I had sat in a call room before with a bunch of providers saying, hey, we have this 25-weeker that was so strong they never required intubation with a breathing tube to actually go onto the vent, had a less invasive type respiratory support. And you come in and they're like, oh, how embarrassing. We gave that baby his two-month immunizations and now he's intubated on the vent for the first time. Oops.
Yeah.
And it's just kind of blown off.
That was amazing. So you told us that on May 1st. And then you contacted me last week and told me about this JAMA study, a Journal of American Medical Association, the official organization of MDs, and here they do a study about the adverse effects after routine immunization of extremely low birth weight infants. Tell us about that study.
Well, first, extremely low birth weight infants are 28 weeks in gestation or less, or under 1,000 grams, approximately 2.2 pounds or less at birth. And you had a group of physicians and a practitioner that went into a database of a large neonatology corporation with almost 14,000 infants looked at, and what the results said were that they were looking at the pre-immunization period versus the post-immunization period, and their sepsis workups went up 3.7 times in the post-immunization period, and sepsis means a blood infection, and so there was multiple labs drawn, blood cultures, urine cultures. They go ahead and they start those babies on antibiotics right away while they wait for results. So it's not a benign thing.
Yeah, it's life-threatening, isn't it?
Right. It's life-threatening. And even if it ends up not being an infection, they've still had pain. They've had invasive procedures, and they've had antibiotics given, which is not a benign thing for these babies that have very sensitive intestines. And so it's a big deal. And then we had increased respiratory support 2 times higher in the post-immunization period. And then intubation, actually getting intubated with a breathing tube and going on the vent, was about 1.7, 1.8 times higher. And what really shocked me, I had to read it about 3 times, was when I got down to the conclusion, they said, based on this, there was no difference in reaction between single shots and combo shots, and so you can just go ahead and keep giving the combo vaccines.
Isn't that amazing? That was the only thing they were concerned about. Can we tweak this a little bit by giving them a combo vaccine or a singular vaccine? No, it doesn't make any difference. So go ahead and do this to them, even though, and to repeat these numbers, 112% increase in respiratory support needed post-vaccine. This is the Journal of American Medical Association saying this. A 257% increase in sepsis. That's a life-threatening infection. Just go ahead and do it because we have to follow this vaccination schedule. That is the most important thing to them, isn't it? It isn't the patient's health. It isn't their suffering. It isn't subjecting them to life-threatening situations. It's sticking to the vaccine schedule.
Right. I mean, just to clarify, they didn't actually have sepsis increase that much, but they are saying that they had that big of an increase in testing, surveying, and starting to treat for sepsis, which basically just says, when I talked in that other interview, that these babies have apnea and bradycardia is a nice example that they're having a hard time, you know, remembering to breathe, and so then their heart rate drops and things like that. That's a lot of what they're seeing, temp instability, inability to tolerate feeds. And so these babies are vastly showing big cues that we're normally extremely concerned about in the pre-immunization period or any time before discharge, because these babies have immune systems that are so underdeveloped that if you wait too long to treat them, they are going to have very bad outcomes and possibly die. But in the post-immunization period, we're seeing an increase in that. And apparently we're not worried, because the whole point of the study was to make sure that these babies get vaccinated on time and that it doesn't matter what you're vaccinating with.
You know, when we look at these babies with low birth weights or premature babies, they're really, I think, canaries in a coal mine. We have to look at this and say, if they have this many, this much of an increase in respiratory issues and response to these vaccinations, I wonder, personally, if there's some connection to SIDS. A lot of people have talked about sudden infant death syndrome and just babies that stop breathing. I wonder if there's, we don't have anything to back that up in this study, but certainly it makes you wonder, makes me wonder when I look at all of these respiratory issues that are caused for these babies that already have a challenged health system.
Well, there's two ways to look at it. You know, premature babies are not supposed to be breathing yet. It is normal for them to have some apnea and bradycardia. Just developmental-wise and immature neurological systems, but having an increase is always a cue that something is going on. They don't address that in that study. We do have some studies from, I believe, the 50s following the DTaP shot showing increased or just apnea, but also just a vast change in respiratory breathing patterns. And of course, we haven't looked at that in decades, so we really don't have any data currently on that.
You know, it's interesting when I look at this report, Michelle. One of the things they say, laying this out in the abstract, the introduction to it, they say immunization of extremely low birth weight infants in the neonatal intensive care unit is associated with adverse effects. This is the Journal of American Medical Association. They say it includes fever, apnea, brachycardia, in the immediate post-immunization period. And then they go to say these adverse events present a diagnostic dilemma for physicians, whether or not they're going to give the injection of the vaccination or not. And as you point out in their conclusion, they go ahead and say, well, let's go ahead and do it because we can't see any difference between single and combination vaccines. So let's just go ahead and do this regardless